Blackstone presents Cheyenne Autumn by Mari Sandoz. Introduction by Alan Boy. This book is read by Shaun Taylor-Corbett. Alan Boy. Introduction. Under cover of darkness on the night of September 9, 1878, a band of northern Cheyenne Indians fled U.S. government captivity in Oklahoma to begin a bitter and tragic but ultimately triumphant journey to their Montana homeland. That night, about 300 men, women, and children were able to slip away from their standing shelters so silently that 100 soldiers camped nearby and positioned to prevent their escape from Indian territory continued to sleep, unaware. For the next several months, these Cheyennes struggled northward toward their ancestral lands, all the while evading capture and engaging the military in several battles. The bloody century of war with the native peoples of the West was reaching its climax. Only 2 years earlier, many of these same Cheyennes had helped wipe out George Armstrong Custer at the Battle of the Little Bighorn. Since then, the U.S. government had been conducting an all-out offensive against Indians of the Northern Plains. As a part of this campaign, a northern Cheyenne village, located in what is now Wyoming, had been destroyed in a surprise attack during the winter of 1876. More than 1,000 people abandoned their belongings and fled into the mountains with nothing more than the clothes on their backs. The following spring, destitute and on the brink of starvation, these same northern Cheyenne people agreed to be taken south to Indian territory with the understanding that they would be able to return to their northern homelands if they did not like it there. Once they arrived in the south, however, their misery only worsened. They were forced to compete with their southern cousins for each bite of government-issued beef. Malaria, whooping cough, and measles killed their children. Deprivation was everywhere. After suffering for a year, the Northern Cheyenne people said they were going to return to their homeland in the North as they had been told they could. The U.S. government refused to let them go and instead had them watched day and night. The Cheyennes left anyway. Under the leadership of a brilliant warrior named Little Wolf and guided by the wisdom of an old chief named Morningstar, or Dullknife, the Indians fought a 1,000-mile running battle in order to regain their homeland. Before it ended, tens of thousands of U.S. Army troops were called in to help search for the small band of Cheyennes. While in Nebraska, the band separated into two groups. Roughly half of the refugees, including Dullknife, Wild Hog, and other leaders, were apprehended in late October when, blinded by a snowstorm, they stumbled upon a group of soldiers. The soldiers disarmed the Cheyennes and then marched them to imprisonment at a military post at the southern edge of the Dakota Badlands. Held in a room roughly the size of a basketball court, the 149 refugees spent the next 6 weeks in relative comfort until, thanks to bureaucratic squabbling and inadequate leadership, the government ordered them to return to the South. The Cheyennes refused to go. They said they preferred to die in their homeland rather than return to the sickness and misery they had known in captivity. The doors and the windows of the building were sealed shut. First, the food was taken away. Then the water. A few days later, on the bitterly cold night of January 9, 1879, the Cheyennes smashed their way out of the building. Within moments, dozens of men, women, and children were dead or wounded from soldiers' gunfire. The rest escaped into the nearby hills. After being trailed for weeks, almost all of them were slaughtered in a shallow pit not far from the South Dakota border. Little Wolf and the other half of the Cheyennes evaded capture. They spent the winter hiding out in northwestern Nebraska before making their way northward in the spring. They made it to Montana, where eventually they were given a small reservation in the southeast corner of the state. This reservation today continues as the home of the Northern Cheyenne people. The most masterful and authentic retelling of the Cheyenne Exodus is Mari Sandoz's Cheyenne Autumn. Intimate, lyrical, and moving, Sandoz's book stands as the most informed account of that dark time. Having been born less than 20 years after the events and raised on a frontier homestead not far from the site of the final massacres, Sandoz was in a perfect position to tell the story. As a child, she listened to the Cheyenne survivors who often stopped by her father's place to talk. As a professional writer later in life, she conducted extensive interviews with the Northern Cheyenne people and spent over a decade researching.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.